some of the famous criminal law cases like Jessica Lal murder case, the 2G scam case, and many more. Recently, he was also part of the INX media case as well. So before taking, I'll not take more time of sir. And today, sir will be talking about quashing of FIR. So I believe this session will be very useful to all of you. Please listen to him very carefully. And if you have any doubts, please wait to, till the end of sir's speech so that you can we can have an interaction session towards the second half of the session. Over to you, sir.
Good evening, everyone, and to the team of LawSeeco and to everyone who's logged in right now, although I can only see Neelam on the screen and no one else. Today's topic is quashing of FIR, a very oft debated topic. Most people who get into any kind of trouble as far as registration of first information report is concerned, well, they rush to their lawyers and they say whether it can be quashed and we can get rid of it. And that's the dilemma that the lawyer then faces at that point of time, whether or not to advise his client to file a quash petition. That's the question. And let's not make it a speech. Let's make it a sharing of thoughts on what I have experienced so far in the 17 years. How often courts get into this kind of analysis at the stage of a first information report, how often are they willing to quash a first information report at the outset when it's at its very nascent stage? It's easy to pick a book, a commentary on section 482 and article 226, read about it and figure out to a fair extent what this is about. So I thought, let's make it the why of all the law which has developed over the last 80 years. First and foremost, according to me, what's important to understand is what really is a first information report. First, let's understand, because we need to understand the interplay of the various legal provisions which are at play here. So the first one is 154, section 154 of the Code of Criminal Procedure and section 157 of the Code of Criminal Procedure. Now, under these two provisions, the officer in charge of a police station decides, and to his satisfaction, that there has been a commission of a cognizable offense. And then he proceeds to investigate and exercise all his powers, whether it's arrest, it's search, it's seizure, or calling for documents, calling for articles, subjecting people to questions, recording their statements. So all his powers really flow from 154 and 157. Now, the question is that this satisfaction of the officer in charge of a police station under these two provisions, where he says that, yes, I am satisfied that there is a cognizable offense made out, whether this subjective satisfaction of a police officer, the court will put to an objective test of whether it is actually made out, whether the court, which is presided by a trained judicial mind, will get into this kind of analysis, or will it let the investigating agency proceed and come to a conclusion whether they want to file a charge sheet under 170, whether they want to file a closure report under 169. So how often will a court intervene in that process? There are two remedies which are available to an accused. One is Article 32 of the Constitution of India that confers jurisdiction on the Supreme Court to secure the fundamental rights of the accused. So a bit of quashing jurisdiction arrives from there. But largely, it's the High Court's jurisdiction under Article 226 of the Constitution of India and Section 482 of the Code of Criminal Procedure, which are pressed into service by litigants to get this relief of getting a FIR quashed. But the question is whether High Court is interested in that. And under what kind of circumstances will High Court intervene and say, no, we won't let this investigation proceed. We will quash it at the outside. Now, if we read the law that has evolved over the last 80 years, we will discover that the test for High Court's intervention is rarest of rare cases will the High Court intervene and quash an FIR. So rarest of rare cases, you also get to hear, is the parameter which is also applied for imposing a death sentence. So rarest of rare cases, when will High Court arrive at a conclusion that this case is that rare case? And why this reluctance on the part of High Court to exercise whether it's writ powers and whether it's 482 CRPC? Let's do that analysis first. First, let's start with an example that, for instance, a person, Mr. A, goes to a police station and he tells the officer in charge that, listen, my brother, Mr. B, had rendered certain services to Mr. C. Mr. B, my brother, played his part, discharged his duty under that arrangement. But Mr. C has refused to pay. And Mr. B, my brother, has committed suicide. So please prosecute Mr. C for abetment of suicide. Whether police officer who jumps to the conclusion that yes, it's a case to be prosecuted under section 306 of the Indian Penal Code, whether he's right in proceeding with that. Let's take this example and apply that. Now, police, rightly or wrongly, has registered. But if a trained judicial mind reads section 306 of the Indian Penal Code, applies the rigor of section 107, which says how abetment and in what circumstances can abetment be applied, anyone, any lawyer, any judge will very straight away and very quickly come to the conclusion that in these kind of facts, not honoring your part of a contract or a financial arrangement will not constitute abetment of suicide. It's too far-fetched. Now, in a matter like this, yes, I think a litigant will be well-placed to approach the High Court, knock on the door of the High Court, invoke Article 226 and seek quashing. And most likely, quashing will be given because if there is no evidence other than this oral evidence that Mr. C did not discharge his part of the financial arrangement. Other example can be that if A goes to a police station, tells the police officer that B has robbed me today of my phone and some cash. And it happened at a specific place and it happened at a specific point of time. The officer in charge of that police station gets satisfied quickly under 154 and 157 and reaches the doorstep of Mr. B. And he says that I'm arresting you, you've robbed Mr. A. But Mr. B says that, what are you talking about? At that point of time, I was not even in Delhi. Or at the place which Mr. A is alleging that I was present and robbed. On what basis are you doing this? But the officer in charge of, goes to the airport, figures out that yes, this man was not there, and the CCTV of that area also discloses that this man was not there. But he's already registered an FIR, wrongly he realizes. Now here Mr. B is well-founded in going to the High Court and seeking a quashing. But beyond these kind of cases where it's really, really clear that the accused is either not getting into the breach of the provision of the Indian Penal Code or whatever statute is being pressed into service, or where he can really come out with a very clear kind of defense that yes, it could not have been possible. Take it from me, High Court will not exercise its powers under Article 226 or 482. Because High Court wants to invoke those powers in the rarest of rare cases. Now, why is that? Why is High Court so reluctant to give relief to a man who may even make out a case beyond a very clear defenses, but makes out a reasonable sort of case? Why will that High Court not intervene? I think first and foremost, it's important to understand how the writ jurisprudence has developed over the last three centuries, shall I say, because we are a common law country. We were governed by the British for about 300 years. And in that rule, a lot of evolution of the judicial system took place, wherein we ended up adopting what the Brits were doing at their place in England. First, let's answer what kind of writ lies when a man seeks quashing of an FIR. Well, according to what I have learned over the last 17 years, it's the mandamus, writ of mandamus, which will lie. Because mandamus, if we dig in to the origins and genealogy of British jurisprudence, we learn that mandamus was issued because the courts came to the conclusion that the executive had exceeded its legal jurisdiction to do a certain act. or the executive, in this case, police and other agencies, they have deprived the man of his liberty or his life by bypassing the law. So under these two circumstances, a writ of mandamus used to be issued that has traditionally been issued. It would also apply to civil sort of civil disputes also, where a man has been, say, his house has been taken possession of, he was on rent without issuing a show cause notice, all those things. Writ of mandamus, why is the High Court reluctant to do? Now let's address that point straight away. For that, it's important to understand how writ jurisprudence developed in the last 200 years. Well, if we go back to 1774, when India had become under British rule, that's the first time that a Supreme Court was constituted at Fort William, Calcutta. And by a royal charter, the power to issue writs were given to the judges who presided that court. Those powers constituted powers to issue 5 writs, which are now you will find mentioned in Article 226. Habeas corpus was the only writ of right. No other writ was a matter of right. Every other writ was classified as a prerogative writ of the king or the ruling monarch of England. It could have been a mandamus or certiorari or prohibition or quo warranto. So all the 4 writs other than habeas corpus were prerogative writs, were writs of discretion. That discretion rested in the hands of the king and the ruling monarch, or the court which was presiding over, for instance, the Supreme Court, which was constituted at Calcutta. Now, over the next 2 centuries, we saw a lot of development in India as far as the judicial system taking shape is concerned. In 1798, Bombay High Court and Madras High Court came into being. Then in 1861, the High Court Act was passed by the British Parliament. All these 3 courts, Bombay, Madras, and Calcutta, became Presidency High Court. Important development of 1861 was also that Code of Criminal Procedure for the first time was applied to India, side by side. And these writs continued in action, that all through these developments, whether they were treated as Supreme Court or Recorder Courts or High Court, the writ jurisdiction continued. But the scope of that writ jurisdiction remained discretionary. Discretionary because, now why? Let's get into that. We've seen initially, before India adopted its constitution in 1950, even under the British system of administration of justice and governance, there were clean lines, clear demarcations of powers which the different heads of government were exercising. Now, everyone here present would know that there are 3 pillars of governance of constitution. It's the executive, it's the parliament, and it's the judiciary. Now, parliament, of course, we're not getting to a question. Executive, of course, constitutes not just the minister, the union cabinet, but also its various officers. So a police officer or a CBI officer or an ED officer would fall into the category of executive. Now, that discipline which these legs of government have maintained is that there will be minimum interference in our respective functions. So the courts will be reluctant under the British system to intervene in what parliament is doing or what the executive is doing, unless it is made out before the court that what those 2 legs of the government are doing are beyond the contours of law or fair play, which the courts have established. For that, the courts are willing to give a lot of leeway to both executive and parliament in proving that what they did was within the contours of law and not beyond it. That's how the system has been. So this reluctance can be traced back to the doctrine of separation of powers. 1950 onwards, when our dominion status was given away and we became a republic and we had a written constitution in place, it became even more predominant. Now, there were very well-defined executive, parliament, and judiciary. Their functions were very well-defined under the constitution. And there was this unwritten rule of not and minimum interference in each other's powers. We are confined here to criminal process. Even in that, the approach of the courts all through these years has been of minimum interference. And that's where you see the relation between reluctance to apply and invoke 226 to quash an FIR and applying the rarest of rare category principle that we will not interfere unless you make out a case of outrageousness by the administration or the executive. So, and that's how Privy Council also sort of interpreted it. So the first case which one can dig out while discussing this issue is the case of Khwaja Nazir Ahmad, which the Privy Council, of course, the court sitting in England, passed in 1944. And in their words, they said that courts have no control in such cases as investigation or even the action of police in holding such investigation. Now, that was a very extreme position which the Privy Council took, bearing in mind their settled principles that even if something completely out of ordinary was shown, they will not intervene. Because here was a case where the petitioner sort of made out a case that please intervene, the police is not acting within its jurisdiction. But I think there was some element of hypocrisy in applying the British jurisprudence of mandamus to English citizens and then to the natives of the colonies. Be that as it may, it changed. It changed when we had our constitution in 1951, our Supreme Court started functioning. And the first major decision in this direction which emerged was the decision of R.P. Kapoor. R.P. Kapoor versus state, that's the first decision which came. And that decision paved the way for courts to have some sort of clarity as to when and how and under what circumstances to exercise that discretion, and whether it's Article 226 or it's the Section 561 of the earlier Code of 1898 or the present 482 section, which now is pressed into service whenever this issue of quashing comes up. Now, R.P. Kapoor also laid out certain guidelines. I will come to that those very, very quickly. But just to complete the flow of how the law moved, after the 1898 Code of the Criminal Procedure and 1952 Constitution, the Code of Criminal Procedure was overhauled. And in 1973, we had a new code, by and large, sort of carrying forward what was there in the last one, but making some certain amendments. But what was contained in Section 561 of the old code was carried forward in 482. Now, whether you talk about Article 226 and whether you talk about Section 482 of the code, the parameters of quashing remain the same. There is not much difference. The question is, when do you file Article 226 and when do you file Section 482 of the code? Now, as much as I've come to learn from by reading a whole lot of law on this point, you file an Article 226 when an FIR has been registered, but the investigation has not been completed. Investigation is not completed, so there is no inferior court at play. There is only executive, the police, the ED or the CBI investigating, and you want that proceeding to be quashed. So when there is no inferior court or its orders under question or under consideration, according to me, before charge sheet, one should file a writ. File a writ. Of course, if you come to a conclusion that the parameters of all those cases are being made out. And post charge sheet, if during when you by the time you're deciding or you're filing, it's a charge sheet has been filed and yet you want a quashing remedy of FIR and all the proceedings emanating there under, that's how you word a prayer, including a charge sheet. Then, according to me, once there is an inferior court at play, its order is also under consideration, its cognizance is under consideration, then you file a Section 482 Code of Criminal Procedure 1973 petition in the High Court. So that's sort of a distinction as far as when to file what. Article 226 and 482, sometimes there is a clash. And there is a decision of the Supreme Court called Pirthi Chand. It came in 1996. It's quoted in 96 volume 2 SEC. Pirthi Chand makes a point that when you have Section 482, then don't file an Article 226. But that's a line which more or less most of the times is blurring. People file both 226 and 482. Sometimes the registry will tell you, even if you're filing a writ to info 482, it's very difficult to argue with those guys because a writ is a writ. But that's how it's placed. But the courts exercise their powers more under 482 than 226, because 226, the availability of an alternative remedy also becomes a point for the court not to grant a writ and go for a inherent powers exercise, then grant a writ, because writ is rarest and rarest of categories that they will intervene and quash. So whether it's a writ, whether it's a 482, let's move forward. Why the court should intervene in the first place? Now, I spoke of a decision called R.P. Kapoor. Now, this was before the new code of 1973 came, and there were petitions which were being filed either under 561 of the old code, the inherent power section, or 226 of the Constitution of India. R.P. Kapoor gave shape to this law as to when courts should intervene. Now, I'll go one by one into the five parameters which R.P. Kapoor laid down as to when courts intervene. And I'll also give examples so as to have a better understanding of what those parameters really mean. For a layman, of course, for students of law, for everyone. So the first parameter for which R.P. Kapoor laid down was, if there is existence of a legal bar, if there is an existence of a legal bar, and then despite that bar, the police has registered a case and is investigating the same, in that case, courts are well within their powers to exercise both 226 and 482. Now, let's take an example of that bar. Now, beyond the scope of CRPC and IPC offenses, if you start going through special acts like unlawful activities or Maharashtra Control of Organized Crimes Act, you will see that there is a certain degree of accountability laid, and the bar is set higher for registering offenses under these special statutes, wherein the sanction even to register a first information report under these special statutes has to undergo a check of a senior officer of a police. I'll give you an example. Section 23 of the Maharashtra Control of Organized Crimes Act, it also applies to Delhi. That section says, even for registration of a first information report for influence of under Section 3, 4 or 5 of MACOCA, Maharashtra Control of Organized Crimes Act, an ACP will give a sanction. And then there will be an FIR, and then, of course, a subsequent proceeding in that direction. Now, if you come across a case where such a sanction has not been granted by the ACP under Section 23.1A, yet there is an FIR, I think there is a good ground for approaching the High Court under Article 226 more, not 482, because it's an executive act. Because an officer in charge of a police station has just chosen not to see Section 23, that his boss, ACP, was supposed to sanction, yet registered an FIR, proceeded with that. Registered an FIR, I think you have a good ground for going to High Court and say that what's going on? Why are they bypassing a legal bar? So the R.P. Kapoor first bar, that's the sort of example that I wanted to give. Similar provisions you will find even in unlawful activities where a senior officer must sanction a registration of an FIR. The repealed TADA had, both the TADAs 1 and 2, POTA also had. So these legal bars, whenever they are bypassed by a junior officers, become a good ground for approaching the High Court. That will constitute that rare case doctrine which the courts apply. Second, and the most often quoted, is whatever is contained in the first information report or complaint, those assertions, those averments, do not meet the ingredients of the offense which is being pressed into service. So you read the complaint, you read the first information report, yet you believe the whole thing to be true. Yet, if you start applying the ingredient of the offense, it's not made out. So even a false narrative, which may be factually completely wrong, if it's put to the test of applying the ingredient, it's not made out. Then you're well within your right to approach the High Court and seek this remedy, I'll give you an example. A person goes and says that I had a contract with Mr. A. Under that contract, I had to supply him goods. He had to make me that payment. He made a part payment. The rest of the payment was not made by him. This amounts to cheating. Now, if you believe this narrative completely, there is no element of misrepresentation which has been alleged against Mr. A for having entered into that arrangement of sale and purchase of goods and making a part. At the most, it's a case where two people are fighting over a part payment not having been made. So believe that account, yet cheating is not made out. Yes. So go to High Court. High Court will exercise its jurisdiction, whether it's 226, 482, let's leave it to that. Third, where no legal evidence is adduced in support of the allegation which has been made. Now, to give you an example of that, what constitutes legal evidence? And it's something which has also I've seen getting diluted in quashing petitions, because what constitutes legal evidence, what character and evidence is capable of having, has the potential of taking shape. Mostly the courts don't look at it, but that's and the R.P. Kapoor principle. So I'll have to, of course, share with all of you. Let's take an example that a man is arrested for having an illegal prohibited weapon in his possession. Neither is the weapon found with him, nor in his house, nowhere. His confession is recorded. In his confession, he says that, yes, I have this weapon. Police makes no effort to get that recovered. The FIR under an arms act is filed. He's arrested. Investigation gets underway, but no headway is made beyond that confession. Now, a case like that, where solely a confession of an accused, which is irrelevant, forget inadmissible, it is irrelevant under our Indian Evidence Act under Section 25. That is the only reason for prosecuting a man, registering an FIR and arresting him. And beyond his confession, the police has nothing in their hands, nothing at all. And they are arresting, they have registered a first FIR, the man continues to be in custody. Now, if we apply this third principle strictly, you have a good case. That person, this gentleman, will have a good case for approaching the High Court and telling the court that, listen, sir, there is no evidence except my confession. Why am I inside? My confession will never hold in court. Why are you burdening a trial court with that? According to me, the High Court will have a good ground for quashing such a first information report. You also see a lot of Arms Act cases where foreign nationals, where the gun law is very, very lenient, say, very easy in comparison to what we have in India. Like in US, it's very easy to procure a weapon with minimum sort of legal interference. And the culture is such where people go and, you know, practice on a firing range, come back. Very often, and every day, I think that's the frequency of Arms Act in airport. An American national will land here and his luggage will be subjected, of course, to a check, and a stray bullet will come out and the Delhi police will be quick to register an FIR under Arms Act. I don't blame them. They have no other way. Those are cases where the issue of conscious possession arises, and the background, the context is that in his country, it's very natural to be carrying a weapon, but here it's not the whole weapon, but it's a stray bullet, one bullet, two bullet. In the bag were recovered. It may have been left when he had gone for a firing range practice. So courts are very, very lenient in quashing those matters because they say there is no mens rea, there is no culpability which can be attributed to a man like that bringing a stray bullet in within Indian stance. So India should not feel offended. Delhi police should not feel offended. It was just a mistake. The man just overlooked that there was a bullet in his bag, a bag which he usually uses for his firing range trips, but he also used that for coming to India. But you know, that's too bad. So high courts are taking a very lenient view there. They say that, all right, let's not subject them to any kind of prosecution. There's no conscious possession here. So that's a case where, although no evidence issue is not there, there is recovery. But the high court even delves into the issue of mens rea, that man had no real intention of doing anything with that weapon. A stray bullet could not have led to any kind of unfortunate incident. So this is the third leg of no legal evidence or the offense not being made out. Fourth leg is the prevention of abuse of legal process. How is a court process abused? How will the court at the outset arrive at a finding? Now, here there may be legal issues, there may be a factual background. For instance, if a man is being prosecuted for an offense, for an act, which was not an offense on the date when he committed it. I'll give you an example. A lot of cases nowadays are arising of Money Laundering Act. We have this PMLA in place now, Prevention of Money Laundering Act. It came into force on 1st of July 2005. But people who acquired certain properties before July 2005, whether by legal means or illegal means, that does not matter. They are being prosecuted. They're sought to be prosecuted for PMLA. Now, Article 20, Part 3 of the Constitution of India prohibits this kind of prosecution. It says no man shall be prosecuted by applying an ex post facto law. Criminal statutes can't go back in time and apply. So if an agency does that, it could either fall in leg number four, parameter number four of RP Kapoor, that it's an abuse of the court process, or the legal bar, the first principle, where I gave you the Makoka principle, the sanction. In either of that, this case will fit, and I think High Court will intervene and say that no, you can't apply a criminal statute going back in time. Good ground for approaching a High Court. The fifth category, which R.P. Kapoor came up with, was securing the ends of justice. Now, how does one figure out what will secure ends of justice in a matter? Well, anyone who goes to High Court on a normal day, not these abnormal days, we'll see a whole lot of petitions where matrimonial disputes, there's one side, there's a wife, the other side, there's a husband. There has been a 498A cruelty affair against the husband and his family. Now they have reached a settlement. They say, all right, let's just bury all the cases, either get together back again or go for a mutual consent divorce. But the condition is, let's just finish this criminal case. I don't want this sword hanging on my head. In a matter like that, High Court is very quick to grant relief on the basis that now the parties do not want this proceeding to continue. The aggrieved woman does not want this proceeding to continue. So a case like 498A is treated like that what's the point of carrying on this litigation? It will linger on in trial courts for years and years. Husband will be in misery, wife will be in misery, families will be in misery. She will go testify, may or may not support her case. So let's just put an end to it. Now that's the category where they'll say, all right, let's secure. It falls into that category that let's secure the ends of justice. Let's finish this case. Nobody wants this case to go on. So these are the five legs which R.P. Kapoor came up with. This was 1960, 1973, we had a new court. And about two decades later, one of the most celebrated cases of quashing were pronounced by the Supreme Court. That case is called State of Haryana versus Bhajan Lal. He was that time sitting the chief minister of the state of Haryana. There was a case of disproportionate assets against him. He had succeeded in the High Court in getting the case quashed on the basis of certain evidences which he brought. And Supreme Court upset and set aside that High Court decision. Now, I won't get into the facts of that case, but Supreme Court added to the parameters which were laid down in R.P. Kapoor. Of course, it cited R.P. Kapoor with approval and laid down two more parameters. So we've already spoken about allegations not meeting the ingredients of the offense. It was there in R.P. Kapoor. It was there in Bhajan Lal. Now, again, was that allegation not disclosing a cognizable but a non-cognizable, of course. It sort of merges into the first one. Third was absurd and inherently improbable allegation. Now, how do you come to a conclusion like that? What kind of case will be so absurd that the court will just look at it and say, no, it can't go on. This is so too absurd to go on. This is too absurd for a man to be put in misery for. Here, while of course preparing for this exchange of ideas and thoughts with you people, I happened to go through a decision called Mahinder Singh Dhoni. Yes, the former captain, a celebrated cricketer. Now, Mr. Dhoni got into legal trouble a few years back in a way which amuses me more than really invoking any kind of legal sort of thinking. Now, what happened was that at certain places in many towns all across India, some posters surfaced. That poster had Mr. Dhoni, of course, his picture, and underneath that picture, there was a caption, "The God of Big Deals." So some people who are very sensitive by nature or who have nothing better to do, they filed a case under 295A of the Indian Penal Code saying that by comparing a living individual with God, the religious sentiments of ours have been hurt. So prosecute Mr. Dhoni for this. So these kind of cases cropped up at a couple of places. I'm sure Mr. Dhoni was very perturbed by that. And he rightly approached Supreme Court for that. And he says that there is not even an allegation that I am the one who's gone and put up these posters and described myself as having some providential or God-like powers. Yeah, big deals or no big deals, but I'm not done any of this. So neither am I accused. And even if you believe this whole thing, it's absurd. How will anyone's sentiment be heard if I am compared to a God? First and foremost, I am not pasted those posters. The Supreme Court intervened. He says these are all absurd kind of allegations. This is all prosecution which cannot continue. And court exercised its power. So this was a new improvement over R.P. Kapoor, absurd and inherently improbable cases. This is one example. Express Legal Bar, of course, it reiterated what R.P. Kapoor had stated. Then came another one, an improvement over R.P. Kapoor. It was called a case which has been maliciously instituted with ulterior motives, wreaking vengeance due to grudge which is personal. Now, it's very, very difficult for me to give you an example of this parameter number 5 which Bhajanlal came up with. Maliciously instituted, wreaking vengeance, grudge, personal grudge, and of course, resulting in abuse of legal process. But I think we can sort of probe and explore the contours of such cases will be if, say, there is a civil litigation pending between two parties. It goes on for years. The complainant feels that he hasn't gotten his due in that civil proceeding because it's long drawn and there's no relief coming his way. He files a criminal action and he completely changes his narrative about that transaction from what he stated in the civil pleading to what he of course states in his criminal complaint. Of course, it's under legal advice. He needs to do some cosmetic changes, bring in the elements of certain offenses. I think this is a case where a civil litigation pendency of several years and then a criminal action coming, I think it might fall into this parameter number 5 of the Bhajanlal principle. Now, R.P. Kapoor, Bhajanlal has well laid down procedure. If we have to run through quickly, it's an express legal bar, absurd and inherently improbable, there being abuse of legal process, no legal evidence, and of course, a malicious prosecution. So Supreme Court set these broad parameters for high courts to follow. That's how the jurisprudence of quashing has developed over a period of time. Today also, if you pick up even the most recent case by either Supreme Court or High Court, they will quote Bhajanlal, they will apply the Bhajanlal test and then test whether or not any kind of intervention is required. A very recent case I read was Amish Devgan, a news TV news presenter, TV news presenter, who ended up making some extremely derogatory remarks against a revered Muslim saint, Khwaja Mohinuddin Chishti. He did so on live TV. He described that revered Muslim saint as lutera and atanki or akramak. Obviously, people of the Muslim community felt hurt. FIRs were filed all across India at several police stations. And this man knocked on the doors of the Supreme Court under Article 32. Well, Supreme Court was not happy entertaining an Article 32 when 226 was available in those high courts. Yet, Supreme Court got into it because there were several police stations involved going under various high court jurisdictions. Supreme Court, while dismissing Amish Devgan, ended up saying that, all right, we allow your Article 32. We allow your Article 32. But when we apply the Bhajan Lal test, we see no reason for any kind of intervention. So on merits, by applying Bhajan Lal test, Supreme Court dismissed. Another important thing that happens in that decision is a defense which Mr. Devgan was taking before the court, a statutory defense under Section 95 of the Indian Penal Code. Supreme Court said, this is not the stage for your defense to be considered under Article 32 or 226. We have a rarest of rare doctrine. We follow that. Unless you make out that, we are not going to intervene. This investigation can carry on. Yes, we can give you a relief from arrest and you know, all these FIRs getting clubbed in one. That said, so what comes out here is that at 226 and 482, even the statutory defense of an accused is not considered by the court. Now, what's happened? The things have gone beyond doctrine of separation of powers. Today, high courts say that what you can go and address and raise before an inferior court at the stage of charges, when a sessions court considered whether a case is good enough to discharge under 227 or charge under 228 and 211, or a magistrate under 239 and 40. So if an inferior court has a power to exercise and give you relief by examining all these issues, why should we intervene? Why should we get into all this discussion? It's a discretionary relief. It's a prerogative. King's writ for 300 years. We wish to carry on the same. So besides this whole issue of not interfering in agencies' investigation and their attempt to bring forth evidence, courts say, we will not grant you relief if you can go and argue the same point and raise the same points before an inferior court, be it magistrate or a sessions court. So that becomes an additional impediment for a litigant today. That high court will be very slow to intervene if you have an alternative remedy before an inferior court. You go and take your defenses, we have no problem. We are not doing it under 226 and 482. Strictly make out a case under Bhajan Lal test, under R.P. Kapoor, we'll think about it, but not otherwise. Now, when I spoke about test number two, test number three of R.P. Kapoor, where no legal evidence, when I gave you that example of Arms Act prosecution and no evidence being there, other than the confession of the accused, no legal evidence. Even in that cases, practically, if I take the court, to take the case of a litigant to high court will say, you go and address before the court below and earn a discharge. We will not interfere. So more and more dilution has taken place even from the R.P. Kapoor and Bhajan Lal test over a period of time. That rarest of rare doctrine continues to hold good. Even those tests sometimes find dilution. So it's become, over a period of time, very, very restrictive. So be mindful of all these things before you advise your clients to file either a writ or a 482 to get an FIR quashed. It's very rare that the court will come to your rescue at this initial stage. Now, this is as far as when court exercises and why, and what's the history, what's the genealogy of all these powers? Why has government been so restrictive in its application? I think the debate gets a little more open when we discuss, is this approach requiring a rethink? We, as lawyers, can't turn a blind eye to the fact that trial courts are overburdened. What a high court exercising its writ powers can correct, it should not be sending that to a trial court to consider. Why? I'll tell you. over a period of time, we've seen that defense will not be considered. Defense document will not be taken into account at threshold stage of quashing. Supreme Court in two decisions considered this aspect, whether defense documents can be considered to quash an FIR or to discharge a man. Now, in 2004, Supreme Court took a very, very extreme view in Debendranath Pandey, state of Odisha, that defense documents will not be considered at the stage of charges. So it sort of closed the doors for defense to argue anything which they may have had in their possession at the time of addressing a charge or a quashing. Now, 2008, a slight shift happens. That slight shift is marked in a judgment called Rukmini Narvekar. Rukmini Narvekar slightly opens the door for defense to produce evidence, provided that evidence, that document, is of such unimpeachable character that the court does not have to get into the issue of formal proof of that document. And that only applied to writ court, not to a magistrate court, not to a sessions court. So only writ courts were given that power by the Supreme Court in Rukmini Narvekar that yes, if you come across a document which is unimpeachable, you can apply your 226 and 482 powers to give quashing or to give discharge. But that power was not given to sessions and lower courts. Now, when that happens, and that's the window that the High Court should more leniently adopt, that if an accused in a criminal case produces his document, which the police has rubbished and is not willing to look into, is not willing to file with a charge sheet, and Supreme Court says sessions court and magistrates will not look into such a document, the poor litigant has no other option but to approach High Court. High courts should be more lenient in taking those documents. And if they see that Bhajan Lal test is not being met out, there is some degree of falsity or it's a malicious prosecution, I think High Courts should be a little more lenient, because what happens as effect is the burden on trial courts is taken off a little bit. Cases which are frivolous, cases which stand no chance of going to trial, High Court can put an end to those cases, and a lot of such frivolous litigation will die. I hope it happens. It's not happening, but I really hope it happens. Now, another important development has taken place, and I'm digressing a little bit from the whole quashing parameters. What's happened is Venu Bhai, a Supreme Court decision has come from Justice Nariman. Justice Nariman has considered both Debendranath Pandey, Rukmini Narvekar, court's power to monitor investigation has been expanded today to a considerable degree. Now, anyone who feels disheartened that, you know, my documents, my defense, my evidences, why are the agencies not looking into it? So before you knock on a quashing court's door to get the matter quashed, it's important to get that bit of evidence which favors the defense become part of investigation. And that's where Venu Bhai says that 156(3) CRPC, this section empowers a magistrate to issue directions to the investigating agency wherein the agency will be bound to look at those documents and then form an opinion one way or the other. So although today defense sometimes feels helpless because I can't go to High Court, produce a document and earn relief, I think this window has been opened. It's a very, very welcome change from the days of Khwaja Nazir Ahmad, where court said investigation is the sole realm of the agency. We will not look into it. So Venu Bhai considers and largely overrules Khwaja Nazir Ahmad, dictum of Privy Council, and says, no, time has come for courts to take a little more proactive approach in ensuring that the investigation is fair, in ensuring that some material which may have a bearing on defense getting a favor, that does not get rubbished or suppressed by the agency. So, be mindful of all these parameters when you in future sit with your clients who are facing some kind of criminal process. Apply these keep these provisions in mind and then decide whether you wish to approach a court for quashing of FIR. I maintain it's very restrictive, it's very limited. But yes, there are avenues open. That depends upon case to case, analyze the facts properly and apply that dictum. So I think anything more in the form of questions, I'm willing to take.
This was a very insightful session, I must say, sir. Even though I've been a corporate lawyer, you made me develop interest in criminal law. I feel like going back, opening my Bayer Act and reading these and the cases you mentioned. Thank you so much. Our audience comprises of law students and professionals.
Yes.
I believe this was equally useful for both sets. And we have a lot of questions, actually. We had more than 290 participants on Zoom, and almost 270 have stayed. So this was quite useful for everybody. I'll quickly start taking the questions.
Yes.
So with respect to Bhajan Lal, sir, Vidit wants to ask, how do you draw the line between illustration 4 and second? What's the main difference?
Illustration 4 and second, I mean, can you just specify if I say that allegations not disclosing the ingredients of the offense and express legal bar. Is that what she means? So I think legal bar is a matter of, I'm sorry. She can she address, can I have an oral exchange with her? She can point out what is.
Vidit, I'll promote you and then you can unmute yourself and ask the question directly. Vidit, you can unmute yourself and ask the question.
Yeah. Yeah, I'm audible.
Yes. Go ahead.
Okay. So first of all, thank you so much, sir, for this an insightful session and for sparing your valuable, precious time for us. The doubt that I had was I couldn't find much distinction in the second and the fourth illustration which was given in the Bhajan Lal case. I'll read that for you.
Can I read it out?
Just a second. Yeah, the second illustration is where the allegations in the FIR and other materials if accompanying the FIR do not disclose a cognizable offense justifying an investigation by police officers under section 156(1) of the CR of the code, except under an order of the magistrate within the purview of section 155(2) of the code.
Right.
And the fourth is where the allegations in the FIR do not constitute a cognizable offense, but constitute only a non-cognizable offense. No investigation is permitted by a police officer without an order of a magistrate as contemplated under section 155(2) of the code. So, sir, I wasn't able to draw a thin line of difference between these two illustrations.
So there's a lot of overlap in these two. The larger point is that no cognizable offense is made out. Whether an offense is cognizable or not, that you will find in the schedule to the CRPC. Every IPC offense is cognizable or not cognizable. What it says is that there may not be a cognizable offense, which is what gets an FIR and its proceedings underway, but only a non-cognizable one. So a non-cognizable offense can only be investigated once the magistrate grants approval for that. So cognizable is what you need to make out. Non-cognizable will not attract this. So cognizable not being made out, the powers will be exercised for quashing the FIR.
Yes, sir.
So you go through the schedule, you'll know which is non-cognizable, which is cognizable. Cognizable is where police can arrest without warrant and register an FIR under 154(1). So cognizable is the more painful part of a criminal process. Non-cognizable people can deal with. All right.
I'll take the next question, sir.
Yeah.
If most of the questions you've already covered, I believe the participants have joined us late. So you can check the recording on YouTube. Mr. Subramaniam is saying, I'm working in a bank and one of the customers had brought fake currency notes to deposit. There's a CCTV evidence to prove that she brought the notes in the first place. When the lady and her husband were arrested and then released on bail, they used their local political contact to register a cross FIR stating that two bank employees had mixed fake notes from their counter with good notes brought by the customer and the two officers who had lodged the FIR against the lady are facing the law for the particular act. Could you kindly share your views on this?
Well, I mean, there's not enough material for me to opine one way or the other if his query is that whether he should file a quashing petition or not. But I think it's sufficient that in the first place, you and your bank got the FIR registered and there were people arrested. So I'm sure it's around the 489 ABCDEF of the Indian Penal Code for having fake currency. We need to see what is the police formulation in that case. And I think police's formulation in that case will exonerate the bank employees. Largely, this is what it looks like. But I mean, it's too little material for me to tell you whether to approach a red court or not. It appears to be a good case, yes. But I mean, it's very little material. Sorry for that.
Mr. Anil is asking, how to quash FIR on false ground 498A and specifically when no incident mentioned related to accused number 2? Whom to apply and how to quash? How to complain against DCP Women's Cell for filing it without reading the plaint?
Well, simple, we apply the Bhajan Lal principle and if you can make out. See, all these offenses under these matrimonial disputes, they carry on mere oral assertions. So the wife will say that, you know, on so-and-so date, the husband demanded dowry and the father-in-law joined in and I was slapped and I was physically manhandled, all these things. There is no way of disproving that initially of what goes inside the four walls of a house. It's very difficult. You know, you will say, no, none of it happened. I'm sure that's your case. Unless you can produce evidence to piece by piece deny that, or prove that to be false, again, High Court will be very, very reluctant to quash on merits. We'll say, go to court and earn your relief. So it again depends whether you can piece by piece disprove the case with your independent evidence. As I said, approach first a magistrate to get that evidence on record so that that is investigated. Well, as far as your proceeding against DCP is concerned, I mean, that's too... it's very rarely that you will see that happen. So don't go in that direction. Don't go and antagonize an officer who's investigating you. Rather, have recourse to legal process. You can get an IU changed. Magistrates have that power. You can get that. But please get your evidence on record and then try any of it.
One of our viewers is asking, in your opinion, was the intervention of Supreme Court in the case of arrest of Arnab Goswami justified?
Legally, yes. Why not? But if you want to compare with other cases, let's leave that to another debate. Supreme Court under Article 32 can, it does, yes.
Right. Yash is asking, what if a crime is committed by a person X, but Y is falsely implicated in the FIR by the police? The charge sheet was not filed even after 12 months. What kind of relief can this person Y claim?
Oh, I'm assuming he's not being arrested, or is he arrested? That's not very clear. Well, you can go back to that old 80s and 70s law of Hussain Ara Khatun and say that speedy investigation, speedy conclusion of criminal process fits into the contours of Article 21 of the Constitution, and investigations cannot be allowed to just go on forever. You can make those points, and I'm sure courts will come to your rescue. But there will not be any quashing per se. They will first summon the material which has been collected over a course of 1 year, examine that, and then come to a conclusion one way or the other.
Hina, your case is question is quite particular. I'll unmute you, and you can directly ask because you have multiple sections and provisions. So let me just unmute you, and you can directly ask, sir. Hina Dawal. Yes, you can unmute yourself and ask the question.
Good evening, sir.
Hi, good evening.
Yeah. Sir, there is a case that is registered in 2000 against 51 accused. They all are blind. Question filed under Section 482 in 2018 and charges framed in 2019. So is there any chances of getting FIR quashed on the basis of delay in trial? Moreover, in FIR mentioned about using of blunt weapon, stay sticks, but in recovery, there was no mentioning of lathi or sticks. And sections were 147, 149, 186, 188, 332, 341, 353. Thank you, sir.
So it appears to be a sort of a mob case where your public servants must have sustained some injuries, and also the members of the general public. Quite unlikely that a writ court will intervene. And as you said, that the charges are already framed, I think they'll leave it to the court, the trial court, to arrive at a conclusion. So I won't advise. I don't think it's a case where the High Court will intervene.
Okay, sir. Thank you so much, sir.
Siddharth Menon is asking in the chat box, what if the president of the country commits a crime? Will the law act the same as for other citizens?
Well, they do enjoy an immunity while they're sitting president, but after they end their tenure, could be as fine.
So I had your permission till 7 p.m. only, so but there are so many questions.
No, please.
If you may permit, we can continue for 15 minutes.
Take the questions, not a problem.
Right. Safa is asking, in a sedition case, IPC section 124A, as a responder, how can I help my client? What are the other tests which abstain court from quashing FIR if the petition is filed under Article 32?
No, I didn't get it. Article 22.
32, she is written.
Well, sedition case, again, I mean, the material is not enough for me to opine one way or the other, but the way it sounds, most sedition cases are not entertained for quashing. So you'll have to await the outcome of the agency's investigation, see what kind of evidence services, and you'll have to fight it out in a trial. That's quite unlikely.
Okay. Tina is asking, there are four brothers and one sister who've inherited an ancestral property. After the death of the father, four brothers and their mother entered into an agreement to sale in the year 2003 and this joint property. Thereafter, the property was sold in the year 2007, but the sister was not party to it. Now in 2020, the sister registered an FIR against the brothers and the buyer under 420 and 415 for not making her a party to the ancestral property, and she is entitled to 1/6 share. Whether such FIR is maintainable and what are the grounds for quashing the same?
And I think these questions are becoming more like whether
specific, or not. Yeah,
so I was expecting a line of questions about the legal position, but well, it's very difficult for me to opine one way or the other because it's too little material for me to say one way or the other. I'm sorry, I can't respond to these kind of questions.
Right. So Sampath is asking, is there any time limit for quashing of FIR by the competent court?
No, there's none.
Okay. How is the conviction in section 418 IPC cases and what defenses can be taken?
Defenses can be taken. It's too broad a question again.
Kriti,
you did not misrepresent. It's a cheating case. That's the best defense, and if you can make out that defense, you have a chance.
Sir, Mr. Gagan Gandhi is asking, can FIR be registered even if civil dispute is pending?
Yes, why not? I mean, I don't take my example to mean that in case there is a civil litigation, there won't be a criminal process. As long as you can make out in the same transaction there was any element of culpability and any provision of law was breached, usually it'll be an economic offense provision like a 420 or 419, 406, or any of these, then criminal process can get underway. There is no bar really. It can fall into the leg number 5 of Bhajan Lal, but there is no bar really.
So does Limitation Act apply for quashing of FIRs?
No.
In case of 354D, 506 and 509, in case of extramarital affair, can it be quashed?
Well, listen, your facts decide what can be quashed or not quashed, because on facts, you will apply the 5 parameters of Kapoor and Bhajan Lal. So yes, it can be quashed if it's absurd and inherently implausible or not meeting the ingredients. So apply those parameters to the facts of your case. I mean, I can't answer these kind of questions. Yeah, everything can be quashed, yes.
Once a quashing petition is filed, the further date or the future date of listing of the case does not happen. Now, what is the remedy?
How is that possible? You mention it and you get it listed. Go and tell the court that you didn't even put a due date. Please put a date and give me a date.
Right. Should we approach High Court in a PMLA case of scheduled offense, not being in schedule of day of offense, but added later?
Yes, 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 of course. There are many, many cases pending. That's a good question. Because the offense of Section 3 PMLA is intertwined with the offense which is classified as scheduled. So on the date when the scheduled offense is committed, it was not part of the schedule of PMLA. It was before 1st of June 2009. You have a good case. The whole argument of Article 20, Part 3 will come to your aid, and it's a very, very good case for going for caution. Of course, we go ahead.
Divya is saying, as per your explanation of third guideline of R.P. Kapoor case, you cited and used the illustration of an American in India with a gun cartridge under Arms Act Section 20. Divya, I believe you haven't typed the entire question. So, like, should I unmute you and will you be able to ask directly? I'll just unmute you and you can ask the question. Yes, you can unmute yourself and ask.
Good evening. Am I audible?
Yes.
Hi, good evening. Please go ahead.
Good evening, sir. First of all, it is an honor and a privilege to hear you. And secondly, I would like to thank the host as well for conducting this session. I'm an LLM student. I've practiced for a bit in the Madras High Court, and I've done most of commercial litigation matters where we've handled or where I've rather seen PMLA cases as well. My question over here is with regard to your explanation of the third guideline, sir. Where you explained the R.P. Kapoor case and you cited the illustration of an American, using or rather bringing in the gun cartridge. So as rightly pointed out by you, under Section 25 of the Arms Act, the FIR will be lodged against him. I would like to ask that in 1925, if I'm not mistaken, we had a landmark case from the Madras High Court itself, Sonai Muthu case, which clearly specified what does it mean by being armed, where two key guidelines were given, the intention of using the firearm and the possibility of using it. So using those guidelines, can we approach that said FIR, which is filed against this person, as well as one more thing with respect to our legal maxim, ignorantia juris non excusat. That will also be applicable because this person should know and he should be having the necessary license and the other supporting documents as
well. Yeah, that's a good point to take. I agree with you. You can take that point as well.
Okay, sir. Thank you so much.
Next question is, how effective is zero FIR in India?
Very effective. You know, the point is, zero FIR is that the agency is satisfied under 154.1 that yes, of cognizable offense, but they don't know which police station and which magistrate will have jurisdiction. Usually, you will see, a dead body is found in a train. So where it is discovered, that place will register the FIR. It will be classified as a 01, won't be given a number. And after inquiries, if they find that, yes, that person may have died in a different jurisdiction, it's sent to that place. So it triggers the machinery. It triggers the whole working of the system. And it's effective. It's, of course.
Whether refusal to quash an FIR by High Court would have any effect on the merit of the case in the lower court?
Well, strictly no. Strictly no. But I tell you what, in practice, what happens is you go to court, you want to quash on Bhajan Lal principles. And by and large, those principles also take care of your charge or discharge. Right? Now, a sessions court, although it can take much more material than the High Court, or a magistrate may think that if this man could not satisfy the court about ingredients of the offense not being met, why should I discharge him? So that that sort of psychological effect is there. But yes, every dismissal will be accompanied with a sentence that it will not have any bearing. So that's more of a practice and what you learn in courts.
High Court, if the High Court stays in FIR, should the filing of vacating the stay order be filed in the High Court, or should a petition be filed in the Supreme Court?
Well, you can file a vacation of stay. Because 482 takes care of everything.
There are a lot of repetitive questions, so I'm just skipping those. Mm-hmm. Please go back to the video on YouTube and you will get your answers there. Is there any limit, time limit in approaching the magistrate under 156.3?
Well, the sooner the better, so that you don't miss the bus, and there is no charge sheet without your material. So anyone who, any sensible person will do it as soon as possible. There's no time limit as such.
So there are a lot of facts-based questions. I'm skipping them.
Yeah, thanks.
How is the conviction under Section 314 IPC? What defenses can be taken? When prima facie, there is death by negligence of medical profession, even though this is not related to topic.
No, it's a fact-based. Defense depends upon the facts of the case, not entirely a matter of law.
I believe, sir, we've taken almost all the questions so far. I'll just cross-check the chat box. So in case anyone feels that we are about to close the session in 5 minutes, if you still want to ask any question, please raise your hand and I'll unmute you and you can directly ask the question. Okay, Harsha, please go ahead. Please note that sir will not be taking any fact-specific questions. So yes, Harsha Kiran.
Yeah, thank you, Samadhika. And sir, it was an excellent and mind-blowing presentation.
Thank you.
Wholehearted. Thank you for that. I have only one question, which is a simple and a straight question. There are a lot of FIRs getting quashed by the courts. So in these cases, can we initiate action against those officers who have unnecessarily caused mental harassment, inconvenience, and a lot of expenses being put by the clients? So can we initiate those kind of action? Because until and unless we initiate that kind of action, these kind of actions will not stop by these officers. So can we do that?
Well, can you do it? Yes, you can do it. But will your clients be willing to do it after quashing and after getting rid of all that? That's the larger question that you need to consider.
Okay. Thank you, sir.
All right.
Mr. Gagan Gandhi.
Yeah. Good evening, sir. So it was an excellent session, I would say.
Thank you.
And one question is that can the magistrate impound sale deed if it is an offence of 448, that is criminal trespass under 104 CRPC?
Impound as in, has it been seized or the magistrate called
no.
for it?
No. The charge sheet has been filed and it's a criminal trespass case. So in case the conviction is upheld, in case the accused are convicted, then under 456, they will get they would want to get the property restored.
Right.
So can the magistrate impound the sale deed so that to preserve the rights of the complainant?
No, normally it's not done. Courts are only interested in looking at an original document and then returning it to its owner where it's liable to be sort of lost or destroyed or damaged. So they do call for original while the evidence is being tendered, but after that they tend to return all these. So I don't think courts keep original sale deeds and all these things.
Okay. Thank you, sir.
Mr. Manish Sinha. Mr. Manish Sinha, you had raised your hand. You can unmute yourself.
No, ma'am. I inadvertently, I have no question.
Next is Rohini Arora.
Hello, sir. I have a question.
Yes.
If there is a FIR under Section 376, can that be squashed if both the parties have compromised?
No. So it's happening a lot in all these false promise to marry and then, you know, the parties sort of reaching a settlement. Supreme Court has taken a view that this particular offense cannot be quashed even if there is a settlement. So you have to go through the rigor of a trial, and there, you know, these prosecutors may or may not support their cases, but High Court doesn't quash it.
Okay.
Mr. Anil Nimish, we'll quickly wrap it up in next 3 to 4 minutes.
Good evening, sir. It's a wonderful session we all have.
Thank you so much.
Knowledge gained from you. So my question is directly on 498A, which supposed to be within a time period of 7 years, which is a general understanding, you know.
Right.
But if it is filed after 15 years, what is the weightage of such kind of FIR? Can it be quashed on that ground?
See, so if you see those sections, 468, I think, of the CRPC, there is a bar on taking cognizance of offense. So even if it's wrongly taken cognizance of, you can go to High Court. It's a good case because there's a legal bar. It will meet the first ingredients of R.P. Kapoor. There's a legal bar, yet my magistrate has taken cognizance. It's a good enough ground for you to go.
Thank you, sir.
Mohammed Rashid.
Yeah, ma'am. Thank you. Thank you, sir, for this wonderful session, sir. So my question is that if an FIR lodge and the few section is like non-compoundable section, and if the accused and the victim settle their matter outside the court and they made a deed, so based on this deed only, can the FIR can be a quash on this matter? And the maximum punishment of these sections are less than 7 years. So I'm just asking based on this deed, sir.
What is the offense?
So offense like snatching or like theft.
See, anything. High Court has inherent powers. It can do it. But in a matter like this, High Court will not intervene.
Okay.
Just as I said that in a 376, it won't.
Okay, thank you, sir.
Mr. Purvi.
Hello.
Yes, your voice is...
Hello.
Yes, go ahead.
Good evening, sir.
Hi.
Sir, my question is, in my one case, quashing is dismissed on the ground that prima facie case is made out. But Honorable Justice said that you can take same grounds before trial during charge framing.
Right.
Actually, we have put up some evidences in our quashing,
right,
but Honorable Justice don't look that. So now can we file charge application as charge framing is not done till date?
Yeah, that's the only recourse now which is open to you and is given you liberty also. So please do that.
That evidences will be looked after by a magistrate.
Yeah, so I think first and foremost, you should you file it. You can also file it as admission in denial under 294 or 295. You can also file it in the form of monitoring that the magistrate can get those documents investigated. These are the two recourses open to you before you raise the issue of charge or discharge.
Okay, thank you so much, sir. Thank you so much.
Yeah,
I'll take last two questions from YouTube. Abhay is asking, sir, what is the remedy available in case if the police is not willing to file the FIR?
156.3, you can approach the magistrate and satisfy him that there is a cognizable offense and police machinery is required for registration. So magistrate can issue directions.
Right. Last question for the day. Ankur wants to know, given that liberty of an individual is to be enforced against the state, should the complainant be given locus to oppose bail in the court?
The complainant? Well, they do engage lawyers. And ever since that amendment was carried out in 378, where complainants can even now challenge acquittals and file appeal against acquittals, logically, every court tends to hear them while opposing bail. But there is no right per se. They can only assist the prosecution strictly in the legal sense, because under our code, prosecutors conduct prosecution, they are post bails, and they are not supposed, I mean, the complainants don't really have a right of audience. So they can assist the prosecutor. But, you know, again, case to case, the judge may allow, may disallow. It's too fluid and a sort of position that one cannot answer. But strictly legally, if you ask me, if I were a judge, I would only allow a complainant to assist the prosecutor, not address oral arguments.
Right. So while I ask, sir, my personal last question, you all can rate the session on a scale of 0 to 10, 0 being the lowest and 10 being the highest. Sir, last question is your suggestion to the young law students who are willing to pursue a career in criminal law. What would your last motivational speech to them be?
Motivational speech. Well, join a good chamber, work with a lawyer. Don't think about the financial side of it. It will come. Of course, money is important, but initial years, you must be in trial courts more, and less in high court. Learn the intricacies of trial. Learn how evidence is conducted, cross-examination is conducted. That you do in a good chamber. So be mindful that your first chamber will leave a mark that will stay with you for the rest of your life. So be mindful of that. Take that call wisely. Work hard. There is room for everyone to succeed. So just carry on. You know, work hard and have passion, and you will succeed.
All right. Thank you so much, sir, for taking our time. We've received a lot of tens here. So for everybody else who joined us late and we couldn't address all the queries, I can see there are more than 70 questions still pending. Most of them were facts-based, hence I did not address them. Most of your common queries were already being covered in sir's first part of the session. So please go back to YouTube and make sure you are going having your pen and paper ready, because there were a lot of informative facts shared, a lot of case briefs, cases and citations were also shared by sir. So those would be useful. And thank you so much, sir, for taking your time.
Welcome, Samanika. Thank you so much. Thanks for having me.